There is a band of women, and to our manner born, emerging from the darkness past and looking toward the morn. Their mothers labored, waited through a night without a star. The morning shows a suffrage flag that bears the...
Welcome to the Allen Public Library as we celebrate 100 years of women's suffrage. And before the pandemic, we had planned other activities, but this may well be the only activity in the Dallas Metroplex this week, which is the 100 years ago this week that the 19th Amendment to the Constitution was passed. Elizabeth Ellis is here tonight to join us, but one of the reasons I personally wanted to celebrate this occasion is 50 years ago this week, when it was the 50th anniversary, I was sitting with my grandmother watching television, and it came on that this is the 50th anniversary of the 19th Amendment, something she had never told me. She said, you know, we wrote lots of letters to our state senators, to our state representatives, to our congressmen, to our senators. And I said, you did? And she said, yes, on postcards, penny postcards, she called them. And she said some women protested in the streets, but I didn't. She thought her preference is to write letters. Well, I since found out in the last 50 years that millions of women wrote letters, and that made a difference. So Elizabeth Ellis is one of the most famed storytellers out of the state of Texas. She was for 30 years, she worked for the Dallas Public Library, some as a 10 years as a children's librarian, and then she became a storyteller. She has won several awards. She's won the National Network of Storytellers Award for Excellence, and she's won the Tejas Storytelling Award for the John Henry Falk Award and for storytelling. And then she's written several books. She co-authored the book "Inviting the Wolves In," talking about different difficult stories, and then she also is the plot of the author of "From Plot to Narrative," which has won a number of awards. You can buy her awards. Go to her website, and you can buy her books. And it's my honor to introduce Elizabeth Ellis, famed storyteller.
Thank you, Tom. Well, hello. I guess everybody has a bucket list, right? I've been telling stories for more than 40 years, and on my bucket list throughout that period of time was the idea that I would love to go to the place where the whole concept of women having the vote actually began. After, like most people, I dragged my feet about things that were on my bucket list. But last year, thinking about this anniversary that was coming up, I put my foot in my hand and decided I'd go to Seneca Falls to see the place where it all began. Of course, I had to buy some souvenirs. This is a copy of the Declaration of Sentiments. More than 100 people signed it at that convention that was held in 1848. I wanted to get one of those banners that would say votes for women, but they're all sold out of those. So I settled for one of the sashes from the Women's Party. The gift shop wasn't the most important thing to me, though. What I was dumbstruck by was in the very lobby. Clustered around as though they were actually talking to one another and getting ready to go into the door where the convention was going to be held were life-size bronze statues of the major people, the organizers and the speakers. They looked exactly like they might have looked on the day that the convention actually began. Frederick Douglass, towering over all the others, looked as though he was getting ready to bend down a little bit so that he could hear what Elizabeth Cady Stanton had to say, because she was so much shorter than he was. Women were standing together in groups of two and three. Some mothers had their daughters with them. You could see the statues were so detailed, you could see family resemblance between some of the people who were standing there. Of course, I'd known for years about these people, but it was different to see them all standing there, cast in bronze. They seemed real to me. Now, they had always seemed real to me in my head, but somehow, standing there in the lobby with them, they were real to me in my heart for the first time. I could see on their faces all the concerns, the hope, and the promise of what they were setting forth to do. So I want to tell you about how this happened, and to do that, we have to go back a ways. You see, when Elizabeth Cady was born, back at the beginning of the 1800s, it didn't take her very long to discover that boys were treated a lot differently than girls. Boys got to ride ponies and climb trees, and girls, they wore pounds and pounds of heavy clothing, and they sat in the house and learned to sew on their samplers. And they were very careful never to let their backs touch the back of a chair, because no lady would ever let her back touch the back of a chair in those days. And every little girl was in training to be a lady from the very day that she was born. Elizabeth looked out the window at her brother pelting by on one of his ponies, and she said to herself, "That's just not fair." She went to her father, and she asked her father if he would teach her all the same things he was teaching her brother. And he said, "You really have no need to learn those things. Why, girls don't need that kind of education. When you grow up, you're going to be a wife and a mother. What you need to know is how to cook and how to sew and how to run a household. Oh, you should learn a little mathematics. That way you can make sure that tradespeople you deal with are not cheating you, but you have no reason to need to know things like I teach your brother. History, geography, philosophy, geometry, why would any girl need to know that?" But Elizabeth begged and begged until finally her father gave in, and he began to teach her all the same things he was teaching her brother. She seemed to have a particular knack for languages, and so he began to teach her Latin and then Greek, and it wasn't long before she had surpassed her brother in both of those languages, to her father's everlasting astonishment. As the years went by, he said to her, "You are so good in your books. If you want, you can come to my law office and sit there quietly. You can read any of the books in the room that you would like. I just ask that you take good care of them." And so almost every day, Elizabeth went to spend time in her father's law office. But Elizabeth was a girl who watched closely what was going on around her. And she saw that men came to the front door of her father's law office. They didn't knock, they came on in. They had conversations with her father. They shook hands, and usually they went away smiling. She saw that women came to the back door, and they knocked very timidly. And when the door was opened for them, they came in, and they spoke in low tones to her father. But to nearly every one of them, her father said, "I'd like to help you, but I can't. The law doesn't apply to you. You're a woman. Why, from the day you married, you had no legal standing and won't for the rest of your life." Mostly the women who came to her father left weeping. They couldn't own any property in their own names. They had no legal right to write a will. They had no say in the way their children would be raised. There were so many restrictive laws that governed women, they even couldn't be paid for the work that they were done. And Elizabeth thought those laws were very unfair. And after one particularly dreary day, when three or four different women had left her father's office in tears, she sat down with one of his law books and began to rip the pages out. She was trying to destroy those laws that made women cry. But her father, really angry that his library was being destroyed like that, told her that it wouldn't matter if she ripped out every page in every single book, because those pages were in law books all over the United States, and that nothing Elizabeth could do could possibly change them. And that part, she really didn't believe at all. As she got older, she decided that, like her brother, she wanted to go away to the university. And so she wrote a letter of application, and she sent all the required information. Before long, she got a letter back telling her that no woman had ever been admitted to an American university, and no woman ever would. She said, "You know, that's just not fair." Now, her father said, "Since you're not able to go to the university, perhaps you'd like to go traveling." It didn't seem like the same thing to Elizabeth at all, but going traveling was more interesting than staying at home. And so she said yes to a trip. She chose her cousin Garrett Smith. She had always enjoyed being in his company whenever he had come to visit her father. And so she packed up her trunk and went on that trip. And visiting her cousin turned out to be an amazing adventure for her. You might even say it was one of the turning points in her life. Her cousin was an abolitionist. He had sworn a blood oath to put an end to slavery in the United States and did everything possible to make that happen. And so there were people who came to his dinner table to eat and to visit. And the conversations back and forth across the table were about subjects that were strange and new to Elizabeth. The abolition of slavery, workers' rights, why, even the rights of women were discussed. It was heady stuff for a young woman to begin thinking about the big world, which was so much different than the ideas that her father held. One night, Henry Stanton, an abolitionist, came to visit her cousin. After a while, he came back again, and mostly the conversation that evening was between Henry and Elizabeth. And then, before long, he asked her to go riding in his buggy, and then he took her to church. And before long, the two of them had fallen in love, and Henry asked Elizabeth to marry him. So she went home to see her father, to get her father's permission to marry, because no woman could marry without her father's permission. She explained what had happened to her father, and he said, "This man is an abolitionist. You should marry someone wealthy and famous and important. This man, he's just a poor man, and besides, he's an abolitionist." "I know that," said Elizabeth, "but if you get to know him, you will really like him." And her father said, "I don't know him, and I don't like him anyway." And Elizabeth said, "That's just not fair." It took her 2 full years to get her father's permission to marry Henry Stanton. But once the two of them were wed, they went on a honeymoon. They sailed on a magnificent sailing ship all the way to England, for Henry was going to attend the anti-slavery congress that was being held there. When they arrived for the meeting, The men welcomed Henry at first, but when they saw that Elizabeth was with him, they were horrified. They said, "Why, women can't attend public meetings. You can't be here. You must leave. Go away. Go back to your lodgings, wherever they are, and stay there. Don't come to this meeting. We can't have a woman at this meeting. This is serious business." Then the women delegates from anti-slavery societies in the United States began to arrive. And some of them, the duly elected delegates, were actually women. And so the men who were putting on the meeting were in a terrible quandary. They couldn't decide what to do. They said, "We can't have women attending the meeting. Why, the people who come to this meeting will make fun of us if women are present. We will be ridiculed in the newspaper if women are present. Women don't belong at meetings. Go back to your lodgings and stay there." But then the most famous abolitionist in the world, William Lloyd Garrison, arrived. And he said if the women were not seated, he would withdraw. And since he was scheduled to be their keynote speaker, they decided that the women would be allowed to attend the meeting, and the women went back to their lodging rejoicing. But the next morning, when they came to the meeting, they discovered that during the night, the men in charge of the meeting had erected a thick, heavy drapery all along the edge of the balcony. The women could stay and attend the meeting as long as they stayed behind the curtain in the balcony where they could not be seen or heard. It didn't take the women long to discover that it was really hard to understand what was happening down on the floor. It was even harder to see what was going on seated back there. And it was so hot behind that curtain, not a breath of air circulating. As the meeting went on, day after day after day, the women began to lose a little interest in trying to figure out what was being said and done down on the floor, because it was so difficult to keep up. And instead, the women began to talk to one another. And that's how those women who were already dedicated to the abolitionist cause, began to talk about what was wrong with the laws that governed women in the United States. They said, "We should have our own convention. We should make sure that the laws of the United States are discussed. It's not right the way women are treated. They're little more than slaves. Why, women can be put to work, but they cannot have any money paid to them. Their money can only be paid to their fathers or brothers or husbands. That's not right. They have no say-so in the way their children are governed. They cannot own property. They cannot make wills. They cannot sue in a court of law." There was a long list of things that were discussed by all those abolitionist women. 8 years would go by before that convention was actually held. You see, the people who had run that meeting, that anti-slavery convention, had no idea what they had unleashed upon the United States by giving those women 6 long, hot weeks to talk to one another about the rights of women. When Elizabeth Cady Stanton got back to the United States, it wasn't long before she became a mother. And she was so interested in abolition, she kept attending meetings where women were not supposed to be. It wasn't right. No respectable woman would actually do that kind of thing. And her father, who by now was a judge, was embarrassed by her behavior. And he said to her, "Since you're married and you're having a family, you know that this city is no place to raise children. You should move out into the country, a more rural area." He thought if he bought a house for her in the country, her behavior would not be any reflection on him, because the people that he associated with would not know what Elizabeth was doing. And so to make sure that she really didn't embarrass him anymore, he bought her a home in a small town called Seneca Falls. He had no idea that Seneca Falls was a hotbed of Quaker activism, and that since Quakers, as part of their faith, believed that both men and women were completely equal to one another, the Quakers in that community were very open to hearing Elizabeth's ideas. And because many of those Quakers were very wealthy, they had pockets deep enough to bankroll the things that Elizabeth wanted to do. They decided there would be a meeting. And before they sat down to make the actual plan of who was going to be invited to speak and in what order, they began to write out a declaration of sentiments like the one I showed you. They decided to pattern it after the founding documents of the United States of America. And so it says, all men and women are created equal. A very controversial idea for the time, for anybody who was not a Quaker. Once the meeting date was set, there were things that needed to be done. They needed speakers. They also needed a place. You can't have a meeting without some kind of meeting space. And there was not a church anywhere in the area that would entertain the idea of having a meeting for such a controversial idea as a women's rights convention. But the Methodists decided that perhaps they would be willing to host it. And so the Wesleyan Chapel was arranged to be the site of the meeting. And then they sent invitations to Lucretia Mott, a well-known Quaker activist, a passionate speaker for the abolition of slavery. And in the days when Elizabeth had lived in the city near her father, she had met the abolitionist Frederick Douglass. And so she wrote to him, inviting to him to come. And he wrote back, agreeing to come and to speak. And so all the different pieces were put in place. More than 300 people attended the meeting. The night before the meeting, Elizabeth said for the very first time out loud, none of this is ever going to really change unless women are given the right to vote. Lucretia Mott said to her, Lizzie, thee will make us ridiculous if thee say a thing like that. But Frederick Douglass said, women should have the right to vote, and you should speak to that, Miss Stanton. And so Elizabeth did. It was such a controversial thought that about a third of the people who were there for the meeting got up and walked out when the idea was introduced. They had been all right with the idea of discussing other kinds of women's rights, but the right for women to vote, the right for suffrage, that was just too outrageous to bear. As I told you, more than 100 people did sign the Declaration of Sentiments, but when they returned home, many of them were so ridiculed by their families or so browbeaten by their husbands that they asked for their names to be removed from the document. That made Elizabeth very sad, especially those that she knew were withdrawing their names because their husbands gave them no choice. She said to herself, that's just not fair. Elizabeth would work toward making sure that women would get the right to vote. About 3 years after the Declaration of Sentiments, she met a woman named Susan B. Anthony, who would become her partner in that work for the rest of their lives. Because Elizabeth had 7 children, needed to run the household and take care of them while her husband Henry went speaking on abolitionist tours, It was actually Susan B. Anthony who went out and endured speaking in public at a time when that was not acceptable for women to do. She endured the hardships of travel when travel was extremely difficult. But beyond that, the reception that she received was often so terrible. Name calling was the smallest of it. She had rotten vegetables thrown at her and rotten eggs. She was often driven from the platform by people who couldn't bear the idea of having a woman speak in public. In some towns, rocks were thrown at her. And in some places, people even suggested that she be tarred and feathered. She endured all of that and continued to use the speeches that Elizabeth Cady Stanton wrote to address the people who were willing to listen, and even those who were not willing to listen, if they would just give her a chance. She spent 20 years enduring all of that to try to gain an end to slavery and additional rights for women. And then, oh then, there was a great betrayal, a betrayal that would cut Susan to the bone. Over the years, she and Frederick Douglass had become the closest of friends. And when the 15th Amendment was proposed for the United States Constitution, and he backed only giving the vote to African American men, but not to women of any kind, it broke Susan's heart, as though ashes had been poured in her mouth. And because of that, she remained bitter and contentious about it for the rest of her life. Perhaps because she had not endured as much mistreatment as Susan, Elizabeth was a little more forgiving. They continued to work both for the right to vote for African American men and the rights for women. And Elizabeth was able to speak before the New York legislature and help push forward the laws that would give women the right to own property in their own name and the right to participate in business transactions of different kinds. They worked steadily for women to win whatever votes they could arrange for them. The vote most pressing, but all other legal rights for women in any way they could possibly push forward for that. As time went by, things began to change. They were growing older, becoming, as many people do in their old age, not more conservative, but more radical. And when Elizabeth insisted on publishing the Women's Bible, her interpretation of the scriptures, it was so controversial that other women in the women's movement pushed her aside and tried to silence her, which was also difficult for her to bear. As time went by, women's organizations began to spring up all over the United States. It was more than 70 years between the Seneca Falls Women's Convention and the time when women actually achieved the vote. So of course there were great differences between the different people who were leaders in that movement. Some were very conservative and felt that the best way to achieve their goal was in incremental little steps, writing letters and making visits to congressmen, legislators, senators, dressed in their nice hats and their clean white gloves, asking politely for men to give them one more tiny little piece of freedom, one more little right. But there were other women, much more militant women who decided they didn't want to approach the situation in tiny little increments. Instead, they wanted a national amendment to the Constitution that would give women the right to vote. Those two organizations would be at war with one another for a while. But in the 1870s, those two organizations came together and formed a stronger organization and tried to work together, employing both of those different kinds of tactics. Those organizations were primarily white women, but African American women were working hard for suffrage too. The three major organizations for Negro women at that time put their differences aside and came together and formed the National Association of Negro Women's Clubs. The leaders were people like Ida B. Wells and Mary Church Terrell. There were too many to be able to name each of those people individually. But that period of the 1870s and early 1880s was an important time because it was a time of coming together and looking at the long distance goal that was on everybody's heart and on everybody's lips. Now, I wish I could tell you that it always went smoothly, but you know that no group of people, male or female, can work together for one objective for more than 70 years without big schisms occurring. A young woman, a very young woman, in England to go to school, came under the influence of the militant suffragists that were working for the vote in Great Britain. The Pankhursts, that entire family, especially Emmeline, had great thought for how to create such sensational actions that the whole attention of the country would be riveted on whether or not women would win the right to vote. And it was amazing how much influence they had on two young women who came to England to study. Lucy Burns, the softer and more pliable of the two, worked for a long time with the Pankhursts. When the two women got back to the United States, they became members of the chief women's organization in America. By now, the two organizations having combined, it was called the National American Women's Suffrage Organization. A long, long title, and usually just going by initials. In 1913, the decision was made to have a big flamboyant parade the day before the inauguration of Woodrow Wilson. People would have come in from all over the states to attend the inauguration. And so marching for women's rights the day before the inauguration seemed like a very, very cagey plan. Taking a page out of the Pankhursts from England, every single detail was thought through to make it the most glorious and flamboyant women's procession imaginable. Earlier, you saw the front cover of the program for that event. All those purples and golds that were on that program and that were a part of the women's parties decorations. These were not chosen at random. They were chosen because of all the colors in the spectrum. They showed up best in black and white photographs. And so the women, mostly dressed in white, with these sashes, marched in procession. There were thousands of them that came from across the United States. They were organized with floats and bands, with college women marching, wearing their academic colors. Women doctors marching together, teachers marching together. There was only one flaw in that parade, and that was that Alice Paul, who was the major organizer of the event, asked the African-American women who attended to march at the back of the parade. She asked them out of fear that if they were not segregated from the white women would refuse to march and withdraw. And since there were more white women than there were black women, out of fear and expediency, she made that choice. There would be other examples of racism that would happen over and over again. If you look in that beautiful program, you will find there are lots and lots of people and bands and other floats listed, but the African-American women are not listed at all in that program. A great failure on the part of Alice Paul. Eventually, it would come down to the fact that the women were not even allowed to process because all the men who had turned out to watch the parade made fun of them and came into the parade space invading it. They dragged women from off the floats. They manhandled them. They treated them as less than human beings. But when the procession was over, Alice Paul asked every single woman who had marched in the procession, black and white, to write a personal account of what they had experienced and how they had been treated. And she saw that each woman's account was sent home to her hometown newspaper so that it was a personal story about a local individual who had been mistreated in this way. It went a long distance toward turning people in the direction of thinking women should have the right to vote. But the United States entered World War I, and the attention of the entire country was turned toward the war. The women who belonged to conservative organizations for women's rights went on writing letters, but those who followed Alice Paul and the Women's Party began to demonstrate, picket, in front of the White House, something that had never been done before. There were people who said that picketing in front of the White House when we were at war was an act of treason. And the women were very badly mistreated while they were doing what they called being silent sentinels. But Alice Paul managed to keep the women there on the curb day after day after day. Carrie Chapman Catt, who was the leader of the more conservative part of the women's movement, deplored what they were doing and thought it was traitorous. And so she asked all the women who belonged to her organization to show their loyalty to the United States by writing letters and by going to work in any way they could to support the war effort, to raise vegetables, to work as nurses, to roll bandages, to be out front where people could see them, making sure they understood that the women of America were patriots. Many stories have been told about how the women who stood as silent sentinels in front of the White House picketing it were treated. Arrested just for standing on the sidewalk, holding up a sign. They'd broken no laws, but they were thrown in jail, force-fed, treated inhumanly. And when the word of how they were being treated began to leak out and appear in the newspapers, the tide of public opinion turned and swayed in the direction of women and women's rights. And when that happened, Woodrow Wilson, seeing which way the wind was blowing, thought, a time will come when women will have the vote. And when they do, I want to make sure they vote for me and for my party and support us. And so he came out as being in favor of women having the right to vote. It passed through Congress and went to the states to be ratified. Some ratified it quickly. The southern states mostly refused to touch it. It all came down. 35 states had ratified it. One more was needed. Connecticut refused to touch it. Tennessee, the most unlikely place and almost southern state, agreed that they would hold a meeting and the entire world descended on Nashville. Both the conservatives and the more militant, but also the women who had been opposed to suffrage, men of every stripe, mostly men who were opposed to women being granted suffrage, all stayed in the same hotel. There were dirty, dirty tricks that were played. One legislator even received a telegram saying that his son had been taken gravely ill and he must come to Memphis immediately, a ploy to make him miss the vote. When the vote was held at first, it was tied at 48-48. A second time, 48-48. But eventually, that third vote, the youngest man in the Tennessee State Legislature, 25 years old from Eastern Tennessee, a young man named Harry Byrne, who had come that morning with a red rose in his boutonniere showing he was opposed to the bill, received a letter from his mother, Phoebe. It said, "Harry, I pray to read in the paper that you have done the right thing. Vote for ratification and help Mrs. Catt put the rat in ratification." And so, Harry Byrne took that red rose from out of his boutonniere and threw it on the floor of the legislature and stepped on it and stepped across the aisle and voted to give women the right to vote. Women won that vote by the act of one man. Later, when he was asked why he had changed his vote, especially since he knew that his political mentor was so opposed to it, Harry said, "My mother owns a farm. The men who work for her can neither read nor write, but they all have the vote. My mother subscribes to 4 or 5 newspapers and reads them from cover to cover every single time she receives one. How could it be fair that a woman who works so hard at educating herself is not allowed to go to the polls while those men who are illiterate and often sell their votes for whiskey? It just isn't fair. And besides, a boy can never go wrong doing whatever his mother advises him to do." And so women in the United States won the vote by the vote of just one man. Hooray for Harry Byrne. All those people who worked so long, so hard, so diligently, and in so many different kinds of ways, with so many philosophies about how best to achieve the vote, We remember and tell stories about some of the leaders. But perhaps people in your own family have stories that have been passed down about the work they did to make sure that women won the right to vote. This is an election year. I hope that you will go to the polls proudly, male or female, and cast your vote, knowing that it has been hard won for you by many, many people. Thank you.
We have some questions from our television audience.
All right.
Can you speak to the restrictive laws in Dallas in the modern era when some of the laws changed? I recall that women attorneys in Dallas in the 60s had to have male law clerks sign for their filings to the courts in cases at law. Right. Banks would not make small loans to women without a husband or male guardian co-signing the loan documents, and women could not own property in their own name unless attaining a femme sol legal declaration.
Exactly. I came to Dallas from Eastern Tennessee in 1969 to work for the Dallas Public Library. Only recently at that time had Miss Lillian Bradshaw, who was the head of the city department of the library, been allowed to attend city meetings, the meetings of all the managers, the city departments, because they were intentionally held at the Dallas Club, where women were not allowed, as a way of excluding her. I took out a loan, or thought I was going to, at the City Credit Union in 1969. And I was asked whether or not my father would be willing to come and co-sign for me. And I explained that that would be impossible because my father had died in World War II. Then they asked if my husband could co-sign. I told them I was divorced. I put in the same amount of money in a savings account as the amount of money I was asking for in the loan. And still the loan was refused to me because I didn't have a co-signer. I had to put in more money than the amount of the loan in order to get the loan. And the purpose of the loan was simply to try to establish credit in my own name in my new state. So there were so many indignities that women had to go through in the past, and they aren't all over, I'm sorry to say.
We had another question. After the 19th Amendment was ratified, the women took a lot of their energies and established book clubs, helped libraries get started, garden clubs.
Right.
And of course, I think one thing that during World War I, people were very impressed with how the women helped with the helped the servicemen with operating canteens and things
right.
like that.
Right.
Could you address those?
Well, once women won the right to vote, it was almost like floodgates had been thrown open. More women began to go to college. More women began to have careers. More women were out in the workforce. Many women were less likely to be completely consumed by their lives as wives and mothers, and to be able to try to start businesses on their own, to take advantage of the rights that were beginning slowly to open.